Olá, boa tarde. Good afternoon and welcome everyone to the 2020 edition of the Fulbright Portugal Forum. The Fulbright program, as you know, promotes mutual understanding between Portugal and the US by developing and offering educational and cultural exchanges opportunities. 2020 marks the 60th anniversary of the Fulbright Commission in Portugal, which was created in 1960. Unfortunately, this year, the pandemic situation the world lives in had a strong impact on the Fulbright program. A number of grantees had their stays shortened, both in Portugal and in the US. And of course, the anniversary commemorations had to be put on hold because of COVID-19. In what concerns the organization of the Fulbright Forum, however, social distancing was not an obstacle. It could even be looked upon as an opportunity. The forum is a regular annual event where current grantees and alumni of the Fulbright Commission in Portugal get together to share their projects and their experiences as Fulbrighters. The inevitable decision to move the forum from an event in person to an online conference, in fact, generated the interest of a large number of current grantees, alumni of all generations, American and Portuguese, who volunteered to speak and give their testimonies around the topics of diversity, inclusion, and sustainability, which have been inspiring the Commission during this anniversary year. So instead of one afternoon in May that was initially planned, we now will have three Friday afternoons today, and then May 15 and May 22nd. Those afternoons will be packed with presentations, debate, and sharing. I do hope you enjoy the Fulbright Portugal Forum 2020, and I'll be joined by Professor Ansley Ricks, Chair of the Board of Directors of the Fulbright Commission, whom I invite now to welcome the speakers and the attendees of the forum. So Elsa, thank you so much, and please take the floor.
As also some benefits, it allows the participation of speakers and listeners that were difficult to physically get together. So it's possible to have much more participants in those events because we don't need to travel and to check our agendas if you can go to Lisbon or to Porto and if you can travel between United States and Portugal, which you cannot now. So assuming the mission of Fulbright, it is my belief that Fulbrighters have an important role to play on promoting diversity, in promoting multiculturalism and inclusion as a way of life, and are essential agents and actors of creating changes towards a sustainable world. And when I'm talking about a sustainable world, I am considering it in a comprehensive context, including the societal, the environmental, and the economic dimensions of sustainability. I hope you will enjoy the next talk from seven Fulbrighters, some current Fulbrighters, some Fulbrighters in the past, but as you know, once a Fulbrighter, always a Fulbrighter. And of course, I believe they have ideas and experience that are important to be shared and to be debated along this forum. Let's hear, let's debate. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Elsa. And so,
thank you, Otilia. So the floor now is yours to invite the first speaker for the first small talk.
Thank you. And before we start, let me just tell you how the forum will be organized. Each speaker will be introduced briefly by me, and we'll have a 15-minute presentation, which will be followed by a short Q&A period. You are all welcome to send in your questions and your comments, by, if possible, in English, via the chat box in the Zoom software, and I will address those questions to each speaker. The program also includes a period for debate and Q&A in the end of all presentations. Hopefully, we'll have a debate even between speakers. We plan to record the forum and later make it available on our website and on social media. And I will start let me
interrupt you, Otilia. Mm-hmm. When you mentioned that you should, that the assistants should send by the chat in Zoom, mm-hmm. should send the question or only send the intention to make a question?
No, if possible, type the question and I will read it to the speaker. That's the plan.
Okay.
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 And since we have somehow a large audience, I think this will work better. Okay, so our first speaker will be André Peralta Santos. André is a medical doctor and an experienced public health specialist. He worked for the World Health Organization and the European Commission, and he has been an advisor to national governments. André is pursuing a PhD at University of Washington as a Fulbrighter, of course, and is focusing on health policies, impact in population health trajectories. André got back from the US after the COVID crisis was declared, the pandemic was declared. And we are very glad to have you here with us today, André. Please take the floor, please.
Well, thank you so much, Otilia. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here and to speak with you and share some of my projects that I'm very excited to speak about. I prepared some slides. If I'm speaking too much, please do stop me. And I will try to share my screen now, see if this works. Can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Yes, you can, perfectly.
Cool, I'll start. So, well, I will speak about the pandemic and also my Fulbright experience and what I learned as a Fulbrighter. I'm currently a Fulbrighter, as Otilia said, at the University of Washington. And what tools did this experience gave me to be a better medical doctor and better researcher and also a better citizen. And I will start and share with you, I have some technical issues. Apologies. Okay, yeah, so I will share with you what I think it's a great picture. It's like the anatomy of Dr. Pulp, but the Portuguese one. This is a picture of Dr. Ricardo Jorge. He was a Portuguese physician in the late 19th century. And this was during the last epidemic, the plague epidemic of Porto in the north of Portugal. And he was a public health physician. He was asked by the government to go to Porto and assess the situation. And actually this was the last time, so it was more than 100 years ago, that we had cordon sanitaire. It's like a lockdown of a city. And that was because it was around Porto during the late 19th century. And this is Dr. Ricardo Jorge addressing a plenary of merchants in Porto in what is currently Palácio de Cristal. As you can see, there's a lot of people, and some of the merchants were very upset with Dr. Ricardo Jorge because he wanted to implement public health measures to contain the epidemic. And well, I'm a public health doctor as well, and I was trained to deal with outbreaks, epidemics, and I'm currently in Seattle, Washington. And I'm doing my PhD there. I'm a third year student. But the epidemic changed a little bit. The pandemic changed a little bit my course of action. So when the pandemic broke, I was doing my studies. I was a research assistant, and I asked to volunteer with the Seattle King County to help with the pandemic. Seattle was one of the first cities. And I was there for 2 weeks helping the Seattle King County public health units. But soon I realized that the situation in Portugal was getting worse. So I contacted Fulbright and my mentors, and I thank them for all the support that they gave me to come back to Portugal and help here. And that's what I'm currently doing. I'm giving my small contribution to the control of the epidemic here. But it's a very serious health concern, and it was quite unique. And that's I want to speak about that a couple of minutes. So it, as you all know, it all started in China, in the Wuhan province. And something was very unique about this pandemic. So it was the first time in, I don't know, modern history that a virus could very quickly collapse health systems. And it was not only a medium income country like China, but also high income countries like Italy, Spain. And that was so unique that prompted severe social distancing measures by governments. And here you can see a plot of the mortalities of some European countries. And as you can see, this is not a flu, as some said in the beginning. This is a quite a serious health concern, and it creates an excess death. So that means that usually people are dying in a greater amount than they would in this time of the year, and that affects several countries. And it's quite unique because some of those countries have very different responses. In Europe, most of them impose lockdown measures, so social distancing measures, either closing schools, closing small shops, and restricting mass gatherings. But what I think, and later I'll share with you some of my research projects, what I think it's quite unique, it's governments dealt with that. They imposed the same restrictions, but they dealt with the crisis very differently. And some governments were more swift imposing the measures. Some of them were more were slower. And actually, the Portuguese government were quite swift imposing the restrictions. We were a bit fortunate, because we could see what's going on in Italy. Italy was the first country in Europe being severely hit by the pandemic. And we had a few weeks in advance to prepare. And linking with some of the new knowledge that I acquired during my Fulbright experience, and it was actually, I think life teaches a lot of things. And one of the things that I learned during my Fulbright experience is to be quite humble. And you never know what kind of skills you will learn during your PhD experience. And one of the skills I became, well, better than I would expect, let's put it this way, in doing data analysis. So dealing with large amount of data and doing some complicated analysis. And I put that to use when I came back to Portugal, and I'm at the board of the Portuguese Medical Doctors Association, and created a website to monitor the epidemic and to do a more descriptive analysis, but also to do some more insightful analysis and to see if the epidemic is expanding or contracting, and measuring one thing that probably you heard already, it's called the RT, so the reproductive number. And that's a complicated math that gives you, on average, a new infection transmits disease to how many people. And it's bad if it's above one, it's good if it's below one. And this is a quite insightful graph, I think, as well. And as I said before, this epidemic could be quite severe if nothing, if no intervention was done. And you can see in this graph that if the no intervention, the epidemic will have an exponential growth and very quickly collapse health systems, and the society could have like severe consequences. So we imposed restrictions, and this was the hammer, because it's a very dull measure to restrict everyone. And now we are currently entering the dense phase. So the epidemic is more controlled in Europe, and we are fine-tuning what kind of measures do we need to control the epidemic. And this is a research area quite interesting, because we know broadly what measures work, we are still trying to find what makes them better. So the smart lockdown. We don't need to lock down the whole society. Maybe we just need to do small interventions, maybe in some geographical area, to tackle the virus. And I want to tell you a brief story. So I wrote my Fulbright application, I think it was late 2015. So I was in Brussels that time. It was the another epidemic. It was the Ebola epidemic at that time. And actually, it's a pity because we could have learned more about how to deal with epidemics with the Ebola epidemic. This was an epidemic in Africa, mainly in these three countries. It was restricted to a small geographical area, but had a very big impact. And some of that impact we now see in more severe way. I remember to be in Brussels in the, I was working for WHO and later for the European Commission there, and there was a meeting, and I remember that some high-level officials said that they were having issues with the supply chain of PPI, so personal protective equipment, masks and other things. And for Ebola, the PPE is more severe because although Ebola, it's more difficult to transmit than coronavirus, the consequences are much worse. And this is some of the highlights, and I will explore some of the insights and that I hope to get into research projects later on. And a pandemic can have severe social consequences, and that's one of the key things. And an impact on trust of citizens, not only in the health system, but in all society as well. And we will still see what will be the big societal impact of this pandemic. And also there's a reduction of healthcare utilization. People are scared to seek care. And this is especially concerning if they really need care. So, and we could have negative spillovers of the epidemic. And here it's a paper that I published with some colleagues at the University of Washington, and we dealt with what kind of things can you do to make healthcare access easier when a country is recovering from an epidemic. I know that Liberia has a very different health system than most high-income countries. It's a very different context. But the broad message here is that probably we need to think very carefully and monitor the healthcare access during a pandemic, but also after, and see how it recovers. And we have to be smart and think about incentives for providers and also to the population to improve healthcare access. Okay, now the more exciting parts. And these are the areas that I'm most interested in. And I did a shift. So I was planning to, I was doing research on healthcare expansion and what's the impact of healthcare expansion in population health trajectories. I think I will do some switch in my research priorities, as most scientists are doing, I guess. A lot of people is doing research on COVID and the impact of COVID. And I'm involved currently in some projects that I think are quite interesting, and I would like to share them with you. One of the projects is to assess the capacity of contact tracing. Contact tracing is usually the word, that technical word for finding a case and interview people that are usually contacts of that case, and to, if they have high risk of becoming infected, to quarantine them. And that was a process that was doing manually, one should say, that it's like phone interviewing people. And now there are some apps that they claim that they can improve the process. That is still to be debated, and have some privacy issues, as some of you might have seen in the news. So this is a research area that is quite interesting. Another research area, it's the negative spillovers on health system performance. And I'm sure that you've seen already some news saying that the vaccination is dropping, that oncology patients or patients with cancer having difficulties accessing healthcare. And if we manage to contain the virus and to get back to the healthcare access that we had before, it's nothing serious, but maybe that's not the case and might be more serious. And also the impacts of the pandemic on health policy. There's a growing debate about healthcare organization, and we will see, and this links with the other one, we will see that some countries will deal with the epidemic better than others, and that's quite interesting. And too, if we can tease out what are the reasons that some countries dealt better with the pandemic than others, we can learn some useful experiences to deal with other pandemics, but also to improve the current health system. And I also think that this is an opportunity, for example, to improve telemedicine and all the virtual, so the virtual meeting that we are doing here. Maybe we can use this if it's proved to be safe and efficacious to use this in healthcare delivery. And to share another Fulbright story. So during my first year as a Fulbright, we visit the CDC. I'm sorry, I should have here a picture of that. It was quite an experience for a public health doctor to visit the CDC. And I met Bill Figi, and he's quite a remarkable man. He was the director of the CDC, was one of the persons responsible for strategizing the smallpox eradication, and it's still the only virus that we could eradicate. And it's quite an achievement to think that human beings are so successful in eradicating a disease. And that's quite an achievement that as a scientist and as a medical doctor, I think we should be proud of. And finally, thank you for Fulbright for all the support during my experience to the University of Washington as well, for everything and for my mentors. And that's all I had for today. Thank you.
And it is a lot, Andre. Thank you so much for your contribution, for your presentation, for your sharing of your very own Fulbright perspective of being in the US and being doing a PhD during this pandemic times. I'm sure it is quite exciting for a public health specialist to have a pandemic to deal with. I don't know if I do have questions. Else, Eric, would you like to put yourself the question, or if you can?
Thank you. It's more or less a long question, so I was realizing in my mind how to write it, but it's better to speak. So thank you, André. It was very interesting, your presentation and your experience in public health. It's a very, very real subject that all of us are dealing with and have opinions on it, even if our opinions are not most of the times they are not relying on true science. And so I would like to hear something. I have, I think, three questions. One is very simple. You present in one of your slides, you present the evolution of average historical deaths in several countries and the comparison with the real numbers in 2020, and that gives you a real impact. At least I consider it a much more real impact on the COVID in the public health. I realize that you didn't have presented data from USA. Is there some reason for that? The other question is about the RT, that magic number that all of us are looking at, if it's higher or lower than one. And that's a more technical question. Does the test rate have a direct impact on that RT? Because I imagine that you might have a smaller RT just because you are not testing enough. And another question is about your last slide, smallpox, I think that's the name. In fact, science managed to have a vaccine to that terrible disease. And but as far as I know, even with the vaccine, to eradicate the virus, and as far as I know, is the only one that was eradicated by human intervention since ever. So, is this COVID here to stay, or can we imagine that we can eradicate it in a short term? And by short term, I don't mention months, I mention a couple of years, I would say.
They are really great questions. So about the evolution of mortality, actually, I agree with you. So it's there's a lot of debate in the scientific community when what measures should we use to compare countries within each other? And probably right now, all-cause mortality, so just measuring deaths and the excess deaths, is the best measure that we have to compare countries. All the other ones, we can compare them, but we really need to be very careful about what we are comparing and understanding the limitations. And the all-cause mortality gives us a crude estimate of what is the impact of COVID, of the pandemic, on deaths. It's there's no special reason why I didn't show US data. I think the US are having some challenges dealing with the epidemic, mainly with testing. I think that's one of the main issues. I think that might have underestimated our difficulties to expand not only to have the tests, but to have the infrastructure to expand the testing. And New York and several cities are dealing differently with the virus. Seattle, for example, it was a story of success. So it was probably the first city being hit by this pandemic because of the ties with Asia. And they dealt reasonably well with the pandemic. They were able to control the virus. And here I would like to, I would like to praise University of Washington because they had a really big intervention. So the Department of Virology, they were able to create a new test, and they were able to mass scale it to 2,000 tests a day. And that helped dealing with the epidemic. About the RT. The RT, it's a measure that epidemiologists use to evaluate if the epidemic is expanding or contracting. And once again, as all the other indicators, I see them as a piece of one big puzzle. That's the reality. And the RT, it's a piece of that puzzle. And we should be aware of the limitations. And one of the limitations, it's like the one that you said. So if you test, if you don't test, you don't diagnose people with COVID, and probably you don't see that in the RT. If your testing is limiting the diagnosis, the RT is probably not the best measure to evaluate if the pandemic is growing or decreasing. About the vaccine, it's a slightly difficult question to respond. I think I'm optimistic, so there's some discussions in the scientific community if we will ever get a vaccine. I think we will. There's a good probability that we will. We have to wait a little bit. And I think it's better not to rush it, to be sure that we have a safe vaccine when we have one. And then one of the other challenges to do mass production of the vaccine. And we need to vaccine a big proportion of the population. In the meanwhile, we have to protect our populations the best we can and with the best science that we have. about eradicating coronavirus. It's slightly more challenging because coronavirus have a, they can infect animals as well. Although it's we are not certain if this specific coronavirus can be transmitted to animals, but might be difficult to eradicate. So I wouldn't say that we can eradicate this coronavirus. If we can control it, that's already, and if we have a vaccine, that's already a great news.
Thank you, André. We have a couple of questions more for you. I would ask you one more and then leave the others, if you don't mind, to the debate period at the end of the panels. So I don't know if you can stay with us for the whole afternoon.
I can stay for a bit longer. Yeah. I might leave, I think, five-ish, because okay. I might have to deal with COVID stuff.
You have to go. No problem. We'll keep the track of the questions and send those to you if we don't get the chance to.
Yeah, that would be great.
Just one more question. This is coming from Carolina. Compared with two other European countries, Portugal has been fairly successful in minimizing COVID-19 spread and minimizing deaths. What do you believe have been the reasons behind this success? And then we have a couple of more questions that I'll ask later or send you by email.
So that's a great question. I really think that we dealt with the pandemic reasonably well. And one of the reasons of success was, I think, how wise the Portuguese are. And they have seen very clearly that this pandemic was a serious issue with all the news coming from Italy and Spain. And my perception, it's not scientific knowledge, but my perception is that the Portuguese community start isolating themselves, so self-isolating even before government intervention, so imposing restrictions. And that was one of the issues. So we were able to, even before the exponential growth, we already had some degree of self-isolation of our population. And that's a great thing. Another thing, it's we were fast imposing the political policies to impose restriction, and the government, the parliament, the president, they were all quite united. And we see when we have political divides, political decision can be a little bit slower, and when you are dealing with a pandemic, 2 or 3 days make all the difference, because with exponential growth, 2 or 3 days can mean that 5 to 10 days later you have double the cases. And another thing, that our science community was quite active as well. And we have seen EMEM helping with a new test, and increasing very fast test capacity and making sure that the private sector was also involved. That was one of the reasons for success. And I must say, I praise my colleagues, all the public health doctors that work, and all the doctors and health professionals that work tirelessly to control the epidemic. But I'm sure that this is shared among many other countries.
Thank you so much, André, and hopefully we'll get to hear from you later in the afternoon. If not, thank you for being here with us today. And we'll have the next speaker, Beatriz Albuquerque, off to a completely different topic. Beatriz Albuquerque graduated in Fine Arts at the University of Porto and received a Master of Fine Arts from the Art Institute of Chicago and a PhD from Columbia University in New York. Beatriz is the recipient of several awards, including the Breakthrough Award for the 17th Biennial of Cervera and the Myers and Art Prize from Columbia University. Beatriz's interdisciplinary art projects include performance, multimedia, painting, and animation. Beatriz, I hope you are on the line.
And, yeah, I am.
Nice to hear from you. The floor is yours.
Thank you. I want to start and thank you for the invitation, and everyone as also the Fulbright, as being a Fulbright recipient. And I'm going to share the screen now. Okay. Can you see it? Or?
Hi, Beatrice. If you could make it, yeah, if you could make it bigger.
Okay.
We cannot.
I stop hearing you, everyone. So I thought my connection must be amazing. So, can you see it now?
Yes.
Okay. So, I thought of starting. So, when Fulbright last year, they start having the commemoration of their 60th birthday, I sent it a game created by me that will talk about my own experience, about my Fulbright experience. And I thought to start in that way, to talk a little bit how the experience of being a Fulbrighter, how it is all the process, how it did change my art, and then how everything happened till now. So when I entered as a Fulbright, one of my engagements in art was also the game part, not only the performance there, but the game part. So in this case, I described with a lot of the Fulbrighters that are here and they will connect, that we apply and we're really enjoying, and suddenly we're going abroad to the United States. In my case, I took my doctor at Columbia University, and as the game portray, if you're reading it at the same time I'm speaking, even if it's your second time in the United States, you always have a little fear, support if you don't have family. Culturally, there are some differences cultural between all of Portuguese and the United States. I noticed one of the first thing for me was a credit card was something so basic that you slide it there instead of putting inside the machine, or even the way you do a lot of the basic appliance needs of that we all do daily. Like, it was little things for me in the beginning. And as here as a portray as the game that I played that was then published last year related with the Fulbright commemorations, when you arrive to New York, not only you have all these people that support you in Portugal, and you met all these amazing Fulbrights, Portuguese ones, I got to that came that year also to New York, those was Alexandre and João, which means we were always together, because in the case of Alexandre, she was in my university, in the case of João, he was like a 5 minutes in the Manhattan Academy. But we also met all these other amazing Fulbright's persons. And so for me, like as an artist, there's things that influence our path. One of them, of course, is the school you go into it. You can see on the left that it's the Columbia University. Also, it's the studio, the materiality, the persons that you get, that you connect, that you're confronted, you create dialogues. And in my case, I started doing 3D printings. I'll talk a little bit later. So then I start scanning myself in my performance. And then I always use recycled material, so it's organic cornstarch base, even if it's PLA plastic looking like, because I always thought about that, but that will go a little further in the end. So all that influence, because since you start creating a different body of work, also you confronted another topics. I also thought of including my friends, because what happened is because you start having all these Fulbright meetings and networks and everything, you get a lot of people that are Fulbrightish, and they become my friends from Mexico, Indonesia, Pakistan, and so on. And then they become like also your family. So your Fulbright becomes, we're still connected now because we're in different part of the world, especially with the pandemic now, we do Zoom or Skype, but we connected. So all this affects you. And because of that, then other things happen as an artist or as in your research, like Flash App also, in World Wild in 2011 told me I was one of the 65 new artists that was going, that we should look up to. In the meanwhile, when I'm with my Fulbright in Columbia University study, usually for us to be certified in Columbia University, we do 2 major papers. One was converted as a book. This is the book. And after that, we get certified, then we're actually what they call doctoral students, and then we have up to 5 years to finish our thesis. So that's how it works. So it's about everything for me, my experience as a Fulbright, going to the United States, talking to people, also artwork related. During that time, also there's other persons through Fulbright that I met. Some of them, there's a community in New Jersey. So they did some interviews with me and related towards it, my influences, my art. You can see it in right here. I also participate in festivals because you start meeting persons, and also related to my artwork, I come from a performance background and also public interaction and so on. And I start doing like more like a gameplay in that performance and the installation and so on. So then you create your art change, it changed. The persons you touch is a reflection of the way you are. So by that time, everyone was talking about the crisis. So when I come back to Portugal in Cerveira, I do one of the projects that's the award. There was talk, I also show it in New York, that was about the crisis. Now I'm thinking about a new project because we do have now a crisis. It's just a pandemic crisis, but that will come in the future, yeah. And it somehow will change maybe some of our interactions also with the audience, and in my case, in some of my pieces and performance and so on. So this was more like a game, and that's where they gave me that. I also started being asked to do illustration and artist books that were partnership with authors and writers. So then I start also pushing that in a playful way. During that, I'm still doing the conferences and everything at Columbia University and publish with them, everything always with a game part or video games. In this case, was a Second Life that it was published. Then based on the work that I was doing about gameplay, performance and art, Columbia University gives me the Myers Award. And so this is like a loop that every Fulbright know, you start talking to person and then you start having new ideas and then it changes and then it starts again and then it changes again, because even the person before me was saying that they tweak some things and become because of the conversation, and you talk with everyone in different areas and every way. So one of the last things I did before I finished my thesis, that it's emphasizing technology, arts and games and education and all that together, is that I was invited to do In the Kitchen a performance. And in that case, I already started exploring the new technologies that I have, the interactions with the person, the virtual reality. So I do have a virtual reality video that was recording during that time in the kitchen. And I'm also playing with predicting the future and the shaman ways and everything in that way. I'm rethinking some of these pieces now with the pandemic and see how it takes me, but this is maybe next year I will do that, because I was invited to some events also in Lisbon and so on, and I wanna see how the interaction will be, because most of my pieces are that way. I interact with yours. In this case, you do have a virtual reality one. And then in 2018, I graduated, I finished my thesis, and here's one of the articles that came out after that thesis also. So I created a video game, and then I did some experience of people playing the video game, education video game and all that. The video game was playing with all these art and games and error. And in all my artwork that you go through, I start talking to people with preservation. That's one of my friends that were Fulbright. And I start talking about other people. And they were really admired that as an artist, I already thought about it, which means in my artwork, as you can read in the left, I always thought, okay, I need to be careful with humidity in the case of 3D printing, because the PLA's cornstarch, it is humidity and water. And it's actually really fragile. I got in Cerveira Biennale when I gained the award because I attached them with the glass tape. Someone tried to steal it and they actually broke the piece because they are fragile, they are hollow. And some of them I have with the sugar and other variations. So people don't think, because sometimes they think, oh, it's PLA or plastic based, but it can also be biodegradable, it can also be. A lot of my art, I also do found objects and recycling also, because I think that you should sustain. You also should preserve your art in a way that it stays as you want as an artist. Of course, some people may want the artist, like Joseph Bosch, they may want to desire their artist to die as a person. It's valid. For me, it depends which one. I summarize some, and eventually I went ahead and write an article about that, because that's something I always thought about in my artwork. I always archive and everything. But then it was with the Fulbright alumni and friends and all of my friend Fabian and all that we were talking. She was like, oh, you do that? And I was like, yeah. And she said, oh, but most people don't. And you are your curator or a gallery or a museum, you need to deal with that. And then sometimes, is it this way the artist wants? Is it this way the artist didn't want? Are we changing? It's kind of like not a collaboration, but so on. And so that's something that then I explored a little bit further because of that dialogue. So sharing. As one of the last thing I want to share before we go to Q&A, it's something more recent that is, once the pandemic started, as most artists noticed, I start a body of work that I call the art in time of uncertainty. It's a bunch of videos I did in the house. I'm still thinking about performance related with that time and so on. But you start using more your phone, you start using more the social networks, and you start talking more. And I was talking with Adriano, he's my Jest founder, and he was talking about this idea that was pro bono for free of creating something so they could like incentivize people to stay home during that time and incentivize to have something. And we start talking, and then he got a partner, Renato, and they developed the challenge. We talk a little about the challenge and all, and that you gain points. So one way of incentivizing people, it's through playing a gamification. You gain points, you do a challenge, you upload a photo, you get a point. Once you make a point, you have all these people. In my case, I offer them an artwork. You have all these people that you can exchange your points for what you want. And that goes through a restaurant, a voucher, a spa, a manicure. It goes all the way to play guitar for CDs and so on. And this is something that also made me think now more recently. It's, and when I talk with my friends via Skype, like with Sharon and so on, because she went back to California, because she started with California, then she went back home, then she's now in California again. It's, how do you now, how is art going to look like it? What is it going to become? Like, how do you preserve it? You preserve like in technology if it's when it exists, but what it will become. So that's what I wanted to finish. And if you have any questions for me, well, let me know or after.
Thank you so much, Beatrice. It's so great to see you again. It's been a long time since we were in contact. I have one question. During these times of crisis, art is very important. And it's probably stimulated by the crisis. But at the same time, it goes through a lot of challenges because of the confinement and isolation and lack of visibility. How do you see those two opportunities and challenges going together?
In my case, what I notice is that in a lot of the places, in different countries, you did have the state giving some sponsorship or feedback. And I think that's positive. In the case of Porto, you got the DG Art and the Gulbenkian that already passed. And I thought that was really important because in my case, I was with all these events that were asked and was going to be paid in New York. And suddenly everything gets canceled. Everything, completely everything, even the conference that I was going to be part of. In the beginning, they canceled the conference, they postponed it. Then eventually the last email I say, they do not know what is going on. So in May, the classes will not even start in September, but maybe in January. They're a little indecisive with that. But then if something happens, the budget is not the same anymore. So there's things they can't. So I do appreciate that. In a way of perceiving art, we still don't know how it's going to become, because I already did the digital artwork, like a video art. We don't know some of my pieces. I was invited to do a solo exhibition in Lisbon, in a gallery that was going to open this month in the 27th, also is not going to happen. So we postpone it for next September, maybe, but he's still in the size, and I'm still recalculating because I was going to present a variation of a project that I have called Doctor Artist, that I interact directly with people, and the installation, everything that I did in Porto, in Soares dos Reis Museum, like in 2019 in January, and that's what I proposed, and I did get funding for it. But now it's like the funding are canceling and it's complicated. I'm reformulated. I will still look how it will become. So I'm still thinking about it. But I think we're doing what we can. Also, there's a crisis, people responding different way. Like, I'm not a doctor, so I cannot contribute that way, but I can contribute thinking, giving feedback, offering my artwork to incentivize people to stay at home. So there's all these different ways artists can do it. And yes, you also change in some ways our art, because I start that cycle called the art in time of uncertainty. And now I have all this new work that would never have happened without it, because you start thinking about. So we will see.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you so much, Beatriz. And if there are more questions, you can either answer those at the end, or we'll send those to you by email, okay? Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Elsa. Well, our next speaker is Professor Alfredo Soeiro. Professor Alfredo Soeiro completed his PhD in civil engineering at the University of Florida in 1989, and since then developed his career back in Porto, where he was professor at the University of Porto, and he has chaired and served in the board of several national and international engineering education organizations. Alfred Soeiro is also coordinator and partner of several EU projects in e-learning. Professor Soeiro could not be here today to participate live, but he recorded a video of his presentation about proposed competences for proper civil engagement, democracy, and citizenship. So let's watch his video.
Good afternoon. I'm happy to be here in the occasion of the 60th anniversary of the Fulbright Commission in Portugal. I was a Fulbright scholar in 85, and I'm very grateful to the Fulbright Commission for the opportunity to attend and to do my PhD in the United States. And if that didn't happen, I probably wouldn't be here talking with you, I'm sure. Okay, so this forum to celebrate the 60th anniversary of the Fulbright Commission is really a good idea. And I propose to talk a little bit about the issues related with the need to have competences in general, but in this case, related with higher education, and the topic I proposed is precisely the competences related with the topic of the forum and civic engagement, democracy, and citizenship. Of course. These competences, like I said, are necessary for everyone, but the study I'll present is exclusively, or it was designed for the higher education graduates. Okay, here goes. The The reason why I'm presenting this is because I participated in a project with the Tuning Academy. Tuning Academy is a very well-known organization that has been studying somehow the understanding, a little bit like the Fulbright Commission, the understanding about the higher education courses around the world. And it has been working in several projects from China to Russia, Africa. In Africa, they had an outstanding project involving about 150 universities. In Europe, in the United States, in Canada, in the United States, one of the consequences of this tuning approach was that the Lumina Foundation adopted the same approach and procedure, and some universities are also using it to define the learning outcomes of several higher education programs. And what happened is that this project, Kalohi, not only wanted to address the question of program learning outcomes, like it was the themes were teacher education, physics, nursing, history, and civil engineering, and that's where I come in. All the data is this in this website, and like I said before, the competences of the different programs. The main goal of this project was to verify if the learning outcomes and competences were obtained by the graduate. So there was a big discussion about the assessment of the competences. And in terms of the civic engagement, democracy, and citizenship, there was a question about the specific competences for this issues, and but not related with the subject area groups. And four dimensions of this framework have been identified as a set of competences that were probably the ones that we should be teaching in the higher education programs, independently of the aims of the program, but as a social contribution in terms of the civic engagement, democracy, and citizenship. These four dimensions were identified based on desk research and on the discussion of the working group where I was a member, and that's why I volunteered to talk about this, because I think it's important. And of course, the four dimensions have descriptors. As you know, we when we have a framework, we need descriptors so we know what we are trying to achieve and trying to guarantee or ensure that graduates have obtained. So they are perceived as the minimum to be covered in all higher education programs. These four dimensions have, of course, three types of descriptors. In this case, we have chosen the ones that are being tackled in the European qualification framework and in the European higher education area. These frameworks, they have these types of descriptors. As you know, knowledge is what you know, what you retain for your behavior and for your competences. And of course, skills are the capacity to apply the knowledge. And autonomy and responsibility is how you use your knowledge and your skills. One of the examples that is very common is that you may know a lot about anatomy, you may know about surgery, but you may not be or not really be willing to apply that knowledge and skills to make, for instance, a surgery in a patient. So these are the three types of descriptors that were considered. And like I said, they are the common structure of the European qualification framework and the European higher education area framework. And of course, the descriptors may be broken into sub-descriptors in accordance with the type of subject of these frameworks. If it is medicine, the sub-descriptors are specific for medicine. If they are teacher education, they are specific for that area. Of course, the sub-descriptors have to be adapted to the academic level that we want for the program, if it is a master or doctorate or bachelor. And of course, there are also changes due to the society ethical rules and to the proper assessment. Of course, they have to be defined in a way that they can be assessed properly. But what is presented in this framework that I will talk about a little bit are independent. They are the main descriptors, not the sub-descriptors. And so the main descriptors considered the following dimensions. First, the question of societies and cultures, the diversity that we have in our world and the different types of cultures, how we interact with this diversity and characteristics. The second one is how do we handle information and communication in a time where there are lots of media, lots of information, lots of communication? How do we handle what is good information or true information? How do we communicate? What types of media we should use to communicate? The third dimension is the question of citizenship that is related with governance and decision making when we make decisions, and how do we participate in the governments? How do we exercise our democratic duties and our citizenship? And the fourth is, of course, the question of ethics, norms, values, and professional standards. How do you apply the ethics and the norms, the laws, the legislation, the cultural values, the religious values, etc., and how to apply the professional standards? What are the minimum competences so we can address all these four dimensions? Like I said, this is a framework that can be used as a standalone or can be incorporated in the subject area framework. For instance, in this colony, what happened was that two of the subject areas had already incorporated in their professional standards or framework of competences many of these dimensions. And these were mostly nursing and engineering. You have to adapt according to the subject area these four dimensions, but the point is that these four dimensions have to be considered as necessary competences in all higher education programs and learning outcomes. Now, for the interculturalism and societies and cultures, the knowledge that is considered essential is demonstrate critical understanding. And I have underlined in all these descriptors, I have underlined what I think it's relevant, but it's my opinion. I think it's the critical understanding, what are we dealing with? The second is the issues that are, let's say, different and similar in the societies and cultures, that it's a skill that you have to be able, or one that is a graduate has to be able to undertake. And in terms of autonomy and responsibility, the attitude, you have to demonstrate engagement. You have to interact. You have to intervene in case of tensions or conflicts when necessary. Now, the second dimension, which are the processes of information and communication, what I have underlined is this question of understanding. You have to understand how information and communication work. What is the process? What is behind? who is doing it and why, and that is fundamental in terms of knowledge. In terms of skills, you have to judge, you have to analyze and take your own opinion. You have to based on data and evidence, make your judgment about the quality of information and the type of communication you are willing to use. In terms of attitudes, you have to contribute to this debate. You cannot be a significant member of society if you don't contribute and you don't debate. In terms of the third dimension, the governance and decision making, for the knowledge, you have to understand the process of governance and decision making. Some of the graduates have a difficulty in understanding what type of governance exists in their surroundings, in their environment, and they have to have a critical understanding of these processes of governance, otherwise they cannot understand how the decisions are being made and what are the importance and relevance of these decisions. In terms of skills, you have to apply, you have to support these governing principles. So there is fairness, transparency, accountability, etc., like it's written in the slide. In terms of autonomy and responsibility, again, you have to contribute to several sectors of society, from political to local community groups. What should be the principles, the norms and values that are necessary for a better society? In terms of ethics, norms and values, etc., and professional standards, you have to understand the general ethical principles. You have to understand that the professional standard is different from ethics, from ethical principles. Professional standards, for instance, like we have in engineers, do not comprise the principles for ethics, and everyone needs to know what are the differences between these concepts. Now, in terms of skills, it's important to understand and apply the processes of decision making. Decision making has several approaches to make them better in context of certainty, uncertainty, and probabilistic scenarios. And you have to understand, you have to know how to apply these principles to take the right decisions. And in terms of autonomy and responsibility, you have to be contributing actively to promote and defend these ethical principles, norms and values of the professional standards, and especially communicate and interact with everyone. And this is basically what I wanted to say. I mean, I hope it's a contribution to improve the higher education programs. It may be used in other educational and training programs, but this is a definition of the competences we consider fundamental to have civic engagement, democracy, and citizenship. And that's about it. I regret not being with you to answer your questions, but you have my email, and I'll be glad to talk with you about it. Thank you.
Okay, so I will thank Professor Alfred Suero in person for his contribution. It's reassuring to see how civil engagement, democracy, and citizenship are taken into consideration as we shape the future of higher education, and the essential knowledge outcomes of higher education have those aspects in consideration as well. If you want to send Professor Alfred Suero your questions, please do so through the chat, and we will transmit those to him by email. All right, so our fourth speaker will be Don Bielostoski. He will be retiring from his position as professor of English at the University of Pittsburgh at the end of this academic year in August. He served as chair of the department and has taught and served at several other US universities. Don is the author of several books. His most recent one, entitled How to Play a Poem, from the University of Pittsburgh Press. Don was the Fulbright Scholar in the Humanities at the University of Lisbon in this current academic year. In fact, he's finishing his role there as we speak. Don, I hope you are on the line. Please take the floor for your presentation.
Can you hear me okay?
Yes, perfectly.
Okay, very good. I am going to read a talk and hope that this will come through to everybody. My teaching Fulbright in American Studies at the University of Lisbon falls directly under the topic of our forum. My undergraduate course in African American poetry after the Second World War, not just contemporary American poetry as the title case, involved me in sharing the poetry of a diverse group of Black identified writers with a diverse group of Portuguese and international students. Our last class was this week. I'm a scholar of poetry more than a scholar of Black poetry, and my students were for the most part familiar with neither one. So I had the double task of sharing a way of reading poetry that I've thought a lot about and published about in my book, How to Play a Poem, and learning with my students a new body of poems gathered in Angles of Ascent, a Norton Anthology of Contemporary African American Poetry, and in several recent books of poetry by prominent Black poets. I've had the good fortune to teach at the University of Pittsburgh, which has strong connections to contemporary Black poetry. My emeritus colleague, Toy Derricotte, herself a distinguished poet, was co-founder of Cave Canem, an organization that has been fostering Black poets for the last quarter century. My university co-sponsors their summer workshop for aspiring Black poets, and City of Asylum, a multicultural organization in the city, sponsors annual readings by the instructors, some of whom are the most important Black poets writing now. My colleague Dawn Lundy Martin, in collaboration with former colleague Terrence Hayes, founded a Center for African American Poetry and Poetics at Pitt, an organization that has brought a long list of Black artists and writers to our campus. So I was very much aware of a renaissance in contemporary Black poetry in America and eager to teach it here in Lisbon, where it has not yet been in the curriculum and where my expert colleagues at Pitt aren't already teaching it, so I have a chance to actually teach it myself. So I set us the task of working through the anthology of 550 pages. I can show it to you here. It's a fat book representing 87 different poets. We, of course, had to read quickly, assignments that averaged close to 30 pages at a time, and we zeroed in during class time on individual poems that either struck me or puzzled and engaged the students. The classes to which they came having written on a poem of their choice were usually the best because they had readings they wanted to share or questions they wanted to ask. This body of work led to lots of lessons in African American history, geography, and culture. From the past slavery to the Civil War to Reconstruction to Jim Crow, to the civil rights movement, to Black Lives Matter, the ups and downs of Black history have engaged Black poets and appeared in their poems. Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman, Malcolm X and Martin Luther King, Medgar Evers and Emmett Till, not to mention the long list of murderers who killed Black people and Black young men who were shot down by the police, all have figured in these poems. The northern cities, New York, Chicago, Cleveland, Detroit, the southern states, Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia, Texas, neighborhoods like Harlem and Paradise Valley, even the remote town of Giscombe, British Columbia, all in scenes of Black writing. Jazz and blues and rock musicians, athletes and actors, even a Black violinist who knew Beethoven, have crossed our pages. There were recordings to listen to and references to share throughout the term. We had our challenges. It took 6 weeks to get me into the university online teaching system with email addresses for my students. And my connection came in just in time for me to have to use that system to teach the remainder of the term online after the COVID closings. Technical difficulties plagued my first attempts to share things on screen, and poor connections have made Zoom classes sometimes frustrating. Student attendance is pretty iffy even in the best of times, and it has worse classes went online. But I'd like to spend the remainder of my time talking about the satisfactions of this work. Students have written 6 papers and a final assignment on poems of their own choosing. And I've seen progress in how many of them are noticing and accounting for the interesting features of poems they've written about. A stalwart subset of them have been regular contributors to discussions and brought insight and experience to their readings. And I'd like to share a couple of them with you now, talk about a couple of poems, both of whom, by poets, both of whom were Poets Laureate recently, Natasha Trethewey and Tracy K. Smith. Dora, it's going to be Trethewey's poem, Flounder. That's the first one. Thank you, Dora, for putting that up. I'll read the poem to you, Flounder. Here, she said, put this on your head. She handed me a hat. You're about as white as your dad, and you're going to stay like that. Aunt Sugar rolled her nylons down around each bony ankle, and I rolled down my white knee socks, letting my thin legs dangle, circling them just above the water and silver backs of minnows, flitting here, then there, between the sunspots and the shadows. This is how you hold the pole to cast the line out straight. Now put that worm on your hook, throw it out, and wait. She sat spitting tobacco juice into a coffee cup, hunkered down when she felt the bite, jerked the pole straight up, reeling and tugging hard at the fish. And you can tell because one of its sides is black, the other side is white, she said. It landed with, I stood there watching that fish flip-flop, switch sides with every jump. Students recognized this poem to be about the ambivalence of biracial identity and the pressures on light-skinned biracial people to pass as white. I was startled and delighted to have 2 of my students speak up and identify themselves as biracial and speak about the difficulties and advantages they experienced. They both felt that they were pegged one way or the other, depending on the dominant group they were with. And they both appreciated the expanded perspective and creative possibilities with not taking an identity for granted. The other poem, Tracy K. Smith's political poem, which Dora will put up in a minute, needs a little setting up, and there are a couple of typos that I'll have to correct in my reading. It comes at the end of the 3rd section of her book called Wade in the Water, after a series of powerful political poems that represent the cold welcome given to immigrants in the US, police brutality at the protest of a black boy's killing, pollution of a watershed and poisoning of people dependent on it, the violent treatment of Muslim women in headscarves, the suffering of a beaten Latino homeless man, the painful pictures drawn by children at a refugee camp, and the xenophobic othering of, to quote, them and them and them and them. Them, close quote. So here's the poem, political poem. If those mowers were each to stop at the whim, say, of a greedy thought, and then the one off to the left were to let this arm float up, stirring the air with that wide, slow, underwater gesture meaning, hello, and you there, aimed at the one more than a mile away to the right. And if he, in his work, were to pause, catching that call by sheer wish, and send back his own slow one-armed dance, meaning yes, and here, as if threaded to a single long nerve, before remembering his tool and shearing another message into the earth, letting who can say how long grays passed until another thought, or just the need to know might make him stop and look up again at the other, raising his arm as if to say something like, still? And oh, and then to catch the flicker of joy rise up along those other legs and flare into another bright yes that sways a moment in the darkening air. Their work would bring them into the better part of evening, each mowing ahead and doubling back, then looking up to catch sight of his echo, sought and held in that instant of understanding, the God and speed of it, coming out only after both have turned back to face the sea of yet and slow. If they could, the wordless distance, the day, though gone, would never know the ache of being done. If they thought to, or would, or even half wanted their work, the humming human engines pushed across the grass and the grass, blade after blade assenting, would take forever. But I love how long it would last. So my question to my students, and you can put me back up, Dora, if you like, and perhaps yours after hearing the poem, is what's political about it, especially in the wake of so many overtly political poems? So after a pause for thought, Maria spoke up to say that communication and mutual recognition is the foundation of political life, that the acknowledgement of the other as a person makes political community possible. Set against the attack against them and them and them in the earlier poem, a call to you there is a profound gesture, and a response of yes and here is a cause for joy. I realized and shared from our fourth floor balcony as we shelter here in Lisbon how we have greeted neighbors we otherwise haven't met in the buildings across the street, and how songs shared from open windows in quarantine have done something similar around the world. My student Carlotta added that the yielding to the whim say of a greedy thought was an act of freedom, a human assertion that work does not take precedence over human contact. In the context of this book, it is an assertion of human freedom against a slavery in which finishing the work is inescapable and dehumanizing. No wonder the poem speaker loves how long the work will be drawn out. You may imagine what a joy it was to hear those responses and respond to them as the term was nearing its close. Even as the students toward the end of term are making class less frequently and not getting all the way through the assigned readings, those paying attention can be provoked to thoughtful insights by good poems and apt questions. I'm going to miss those students whose faces I've been able to see close up on my Zoom and be grateful for the chance I've had to work with them. Even though the Fulbright officially stopped midway through the term, it got me here, and it got this class and my other ones started, and it introduced me to this wonderful city, which I've had the privilege of seeing now as no one has ever seen it before. So I'm grateful for this opportunity, and I will cherish it as my last undergraduate teaching experience. So as Otilia said in April, I made the decision to retire from my position at Pitt, and so my teaching here at Lisbon takes on special additional meaning for me. I'm grateful to Fulbright to have had the chance to have this experience and to share this account of it with you, and I thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Don. It was great to hear about your experience here. Yeah, thank you so much. It was quite a different experience from what you were expecting for your 3 months of teaching at the University of Lisbon.
Oh, in many ways it was.
And you're actually near
the... In the end, I stayed with it. I just...
Go ahead.
I stayed with the class, and we got to the end, last assignment in today, last class this week. It's turned out to be okay, even though, yes, teaching online was... Well, I learned that teaching online is not what I want to do anymore, and that's part of why I chose to retire. I think it's going to continue next fall.
And you ended up spending the quarantine next to the commission when we are not there, right? You're living close to the commission's office.
That's right, just around the corner.
Not able.
Well, it's a lovely neighborhood. Are you Are you back yet to see the jacarandas blooming on your street?
I think about it every day, but I haven't been back, so this is quite a lovely time to be there. It's near the parliament. So, well, thank you so much. I don't think we have a question. There's someone saying that it was beautiful. There was a question before that I think I can adapt. It was for Beatriz, but I think it's very well suited for you as well. It's from Sandra Paiva. We heard Antonio Guterres saying that the virus has unleashed a tsunami of hate across the world. How can artists in poetry and literature, how can it contribute and work together to be a force against that trend of hate? Do you have something to share with us?
I can say a little bit. I think kind of poetry that is in this anthology that I've been sharing with my students both documents hate and responds to hate and offers generous and often imaginative responses that, as the students have learned to interpret them, give them a sense of both the threats that the people and people like them who've been writing these poems have endured, and the strength of endurance and imagination that they have exhibited in the face of those things. I can't say that these poems have made my countrymen who are not reading them respond to people like the writers here better. I would have to say right now that those responses in my country are more troublesome than they have been in a long time. But the resilience and imagination and courage and articulateness of those who have been the recipients of hate and who identify with those who've been the recipients of hate. Another young Black man was just shot down recently and is immediately in the news again. Those responses are powerful and poignant and moving, and were they to be shared more widely, I think would expand the community of people who can appreciate the humanity that that these voices represent. I guess that's about the best I can say.
Well, thank you so much, and I do hope you enjoy the rest of your stay in Lisbon. And if there are any further questions, I will send it to you, or we can have a discussion later in the afternoon. Okay.
Well,
thank you.
Okay. You know, we have been saved. We've been saved by Pasaios Hygienikos.
That's the least you can do. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Okay. So we are moving forward. We are keeping the time quite in a disciplined way. So Flavio Azevedo will be the next speaker. Flavio conducted research at NYU and is currently working as a senior researcher at the Institute for Communication Science at University of Jena in Germany. He was named as one of the 100 most influential early career Portuguese by the World Economic Forum via the Global Shapers Initiative. Flavio uses comparative approaches in latent variable modeling to investigate the dispositional and situational processes underlying ideological subscription. Hopefully we'll shed some light into what this is. Flavio, are you on the line?
Yes.
The floor is yours. Thank you so
Thank
much.
You. Let me share the screen with you. One second. Technical difficulties.
Okay.
It means I'm trying to be in Portugal.
Yeah, go ahead.
All right, let me see if I can find, okay. Okay, I think I found it.
Yes.
Okay, all right. It was a little more difficult than I foresaw. All right. Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here and a pleasure to share my experience as a Fulbrighter with you. I'm going to talk about my experiences as a Fulbright Fellow at New York University at the Social Psychological Department. So before I start, I would like to tell you a little bit about me. I saw that a lot of people talked about their research. I thought it was more of a sharing experience sort of thing. So I prepared a little bit about my experience instead. Apologies in advance if that wasn't the ideal scenario. In any case, I hope that this is a useful presentation to everyone. All right. So I come from a humble background and I could only afford to start studying at 26 years old. And it was through a special program of the Portuguese government allowing unprivileged adults to seek a future for themselves. And I believe that allowed me to education, and it was the first time that I was given that opportunity. So I started my undergraduate studies at Coimbra University, where I chose to study psychology. Coimbra gave me a excellent training and experiences, especially internationally, which allowed me to dream higher and higher. And I wanted to pursue an academic career, or at least that was within my radar at the time. And after finishing my degree in Coimbra, I was given the opportunity to go for my master's in statistics, psychology, and political science in the Netherlands. So in 2000, after this parkour, which took me more than the regular 2 years, because it was a little bit complex, and it was more masters than one, and it took me until 2015 to finish them. So I started my PhD in Germany at Cologne University, where I had an excellent mentor that I would like to name, André Kaiser, be a source of inspiration for me. And in my PhD, I pursue a path towards political psychology, and that means that I'm interested in the psychology of political behavior. I'm interested in knowing why, not so much what or how people vote. Why do they subscribe to ideologies? Why would they say I'm conservative, I'm liberal, etc.? Why are they prejudiced against certain groups, and why they engage in political activism, for example? So it was then that I applied for Fulbright Scholarship, and thankfully I was selected and I could visit Professor John Jost at NYU. Professor John Jost is a professor of psychology and politics, and he studies the social and psychological basis of ideology. So he really is a perfect match for my interests. And more recently, I got my first academic job at a German university called Friedrich Hiller in Jena. And it's very good to be an official academic. So I'm very happy with that. All right, so the Fulbright program has allowed me a plethora of opportunities for which I'm very thankful. And I would like to talk about some of these and how they happen. I thought that perhaps this talk could be useful to students applying for a Fulbright or to those who already know they are going to go to the US, but don't know exactly what to expect, and there are hidden implicit rules everywhere, and perhaps this talk helped shed some light into at least my experience. So I hope this can be helpful to others, and here's what I found during my time at NYU Social Psychology Department, at least as far as opportunities are concerned. So first, Fulbright is what struck me. Thank you. it's widely known what it means. So perhaps of this, perhaps because of this, you're given the opportunity to work with the main scholars in the field, and I was very lucky in that respect. And for you, it generates a sort of an unprecedented exchange of expertise. You learn a lot every day in a diverse set of ways. And it's not just knowledge, it's procedural knowledge and how things are made and opportunities that are given. So you're exposed to a wide range of other scholars like yourself and eager early career scholars, as well as professors who allow you to build a network in at least two ways, possibly three. And first is through existing connections with the professor you're visiting. And or professors you're visiting, depending on your special case. And through the professor you're working with, but also because of the environment, you're able to establish connections independently for yourself, other people in other research areas and topics that you can connect and say, I'm in the US, I'd like to visit your lab, or I'd like to connect with you. And as a consequence of being at a top educational institution, I think people, I at least have received positive feedback in these contexts, and I was able to get to know people that I never would have thought of contacting before getting the Fulbright. So, apologies. This process also allows for internationalization of your research portfolio through both new and diverse collaborations, as well as resources in a way that you didn't have access to. For example, in my case, data collection facilities in educational resources. One perhaps funny aspect is that in my time at NYU, there was never an article or a book that I wanted to read or check out that was unavailable or not reachable somehow. The worst I had to do was wait 2 days and I was able to read the book. So another important, perhaps for people taking, wanting to be in academia, I believe this to be one of the most rich and insightful experiences is that you acquire a perspective in the field and of the field. It's as if you start understanding the connections and the literature in a different way, because the professors tend to put, or just by being there, you're in the loop of who's who, which lab does what, and focuses on what are the underlying debates that are going on. And this knowledge is not only to organize the literature in your mind, as well as give you clarity to profound debates that have been going on for decades. So last but not least, you're also invited to give talks in other departments, and you are exposed to their graduate students and their research program. You're offered collaborations from time to time, and perhaps I was very lucky, also some job offers. So it's I'm very thankful for this, for all these opportunities and everything that I learned as a Fulbrighter at NYU. So now I'll talk about what I produced at NYU. So basically there were some articles, but I'll focus on just one. I didn't want to make about research. So in this article, which was accepted at Journal of Social Issues, is a very good journal with Professor John Jost from NYU. And we argue that public policy issues, such as those pertaining to welfare, redistribution of wealth, public education, healthcare, affirmative action, military budgets, law and order, tradition, they involve both economic priorities as well as social concerns pertaining to race, ethnicity, nationality, immigration, status, gender, sexual orientation. So given that neoliberal economic policies affect some people more than others, including racial and ethnic minorities, poor people, and many of the marginalized in society, it seems much more likely that to us, the researchers, that social and economic attitudes are intertwined, they are together, at least in part linked to individual difference in support of opposition of social and economic forms of inequality. And this is, I wouldn't say in stark contrast, but in the literature, a lot of the research argues for an independence of these two factors, that preferences on the social sphere differ widely from the economic sphere. And there are important implications for the psychology of ideological endorsement for this, but I won't bore you with the details of that. So I just wanted to say that this research was, I worked on this research through my period there, and today it's the top downloaded article from Wiley, and I got a certificate, which is on the slide, as well as it got 1,000 reads on ResearchGate, which is by far the most read article of mine. So it has generated some interest. Last but not least, and a lot in part, I believe, due to Fulbright, I was selected as one of the most influential early career Portuguese in this amazing initiative called Global Shapers by the World Economic Forum. And I'm very happy for this prize, and it has brought me a lot of joy. But I really think this has a lot to do with the Fulbright Prize as well. So thank you very much. You can find my social media and website on the last slide.
Thank you so much, Flavio. I do think your experience at NYU and your life experience fits very well into what the Fulbright program is all about, and especially related to the topic of diversity and inclusion. We are trying to do our best to, although we know that the prestige of the Fulbright program sometimes can lead to applicants excluding themselves from applying because they think Fulbright is too good for them. It's not for them. They have a different background, they have a different perspective, and they think Fulbright is not for them. We want to have all applicants of all tracks to come to Fulbright and really enjoy the opportunity of being a Fulbrighter. So, and also your research topic, I have to say, the psychology of political behavior and our inequalities can drive that the political behavior is very interesting also from a perspective of diversity and inclusion. So thank you so much for your contribution here today.
Very much. And I do want to say that Fulbright has really been great, and especially when I went for the interview, and there were special arrangements made on my behalf because I was in Germany, and I can't thank you enough for opening that opportunity to me.
Well, thank you so much. That was 2 years ago, I believe, that you were interviewed for. We were far away from guessing that we would be doing all interviews online this year because of the pandemic situation. So you are a precursor in that sense. So thank you so much. I do have a question for you from Ricardo. This current pandemic has had effects on the global economy. What political changes do you think will happen as a result of this situation? Do you see more of the authoritarian regimes taking power?
I think, good question. I think that authoritarian regimes and populist regimes are in vogue right now in several countries and in major democratic countries as well. So what I think is not super much of importance, but I hope that we'll realize how important it is that we pay more attention to our electoral choices. Vote that seemed to be a trivial civic engagement exercise has now life and death consequences for your loved ones. And sometimes we forget that that there are always consequences of your vote, but they don't tend to reach you or most people because marginalized people are the minority. But it's important, I think, that the aspect that is being put forward today by the COVID-19 in this pandemic is that political choices have consequences, and now it's these consequences are more democratic than before. So your privilege used to shield you from most people of bearing the brunt of the consequences of unequal regimes, and now it's more shared, and the disease is it's still unequal, its effect is still unequal, but it's democratizing a little bit more.
Thank you. And I have a question from Elsa. Elsa Rix, would you like to ask the question yourself,
please? Yes, thank you. Thank you, Otilia, and thank you, Flavio, for your brilliant career and achievements. But my question, I didn't write the question, I only mentioned that I would like to make a question. And in fact, the question is much more and in the direction of the last question. But Flavio, you are saying that that pandemic is more or less democratic. But in fact, when you look at the numbers, we understand that it's not so democratic. And especially the consequences and the economic and societal consequences of the pandemic, for sure, at least in my understanding, and it's an opinion, does not rely on scientific knowledge, it's not my area, but I think the consequences will not be so democratic as we could understand. And my question is, and because of your background in the psychology, will the fear resulting from the pandemic will make us more accepting authoritarian regimes and authoritarian solutions? Not because we like them, but because we justify it as being necessary to deal with it. And of course, some political areas taking advantage of that fear and that acceptance, more acceptance of that in that direction. Another question that maybe it's important, it's because of you are Portuguese, so you have a lifetime in Portugal, but you have an experience in United States, and now you are in Germany. So those justifications of inequality, are there differences among those three areas or those three societies? Or you could not understood that in fact they are different?
All right, so I believe there are three questions. So the first question, I believe you are right, and I believe I could have expressed myself better. I still think that it is more visually, it affects people more randomly and less unequally, but the inequality levels that we are seeing today are so high that I believe the exposure of that inequality is now more visual than ever. Now, as for the consequences, you are completely right. And empirically in the US, which is data that I'm aware of, the COVID-19 is affecting enormously people who cannot afford to stop working and who are forced by their employees. So still COVID-19 is the effect of COVID-19 still affects the population unequally. And this is absolutely the case. So if I haven't stressed that point enough, I would like to thank you for helping me do so. The second question has to do with, is it possible that from psychological research to venture a guess that COVID-19 and the pandemic will lead towards more fear towards more fear generally and acceptance of authoritarian regimes or populist right-wing regimes, because there would be a need or a justification for that, because when you're fearful, you justify the means, justify the ends. So I think that from a theoretical point of view, I think that is very likely. I hope that is not the case, but it has been shown, for example, in approval data by several countries, that there is this effect called rally around the flag, which is that you start trusting institutions more, you start trusting the governmental decisions more, and that in the end yields more power or clout to the current regime. So I see that hopefully the management of the crisis will be a very important factor on the next decision that the people will make in democratically, on democratic elections. Now, quickly for the third question, which is there some sort of invariance, or is there some cultural differences between United States, Germany, and United States, Germany, and Portugal when it comes to system justification? I would say that probably there are, but as far as an empirical research is concerned, the only case that I'm aware is in France, where system justification is related or justifying the system as it is, and this may be your gender relations, economic relations, or system relations, really. It's only positively related to, for example, choice for more authoritarian regimes or ideologically conservative choices in France, where system justification is related to more liberal ideologies rather than conservative. So I would say that the possibility exists. However, to my knowledge, only in France that would be the case.
Thank you, Flavio.
Thank you so much, Flavio. Thank you so much. If there are further questions, we will send those to you, or maybe you can stay with us for a couple of months. Next, be Claudia Mehta. Claudia wants to dedicate her professional life to mitigating environmental damage and protecting biodiversity. She is currently completing a Master's of Environmental Management at Duke University, where she has been introduced to the concept of environmental justice, which highlights how certain communities are more vulnerable to environmental issues because of their socioeconomic status. Claudia, I think that you are online by now. Please join us.
Thank you so much. Okay, I hope you can all hear me and see my screen.
Perfect.
Good morning or good afternoon to you, depending on where you are. My name is Claudia, and I'm studying a Master of Environmental Management, and my focus is in ecosystem science and conservation. And I actually, this was a great previous presentation by Flavio, in some ways my talk links to his. So it's very nice that it was set up this way. In coming to the United States, I was really expecting just to build on my existing career goals and kind of discover more about the intersection between environmental protection and other subjects. And here in a master's program, I've been exposed to a vast sea of resources, and I've really been able to delve deeper into a concept that I've always thought about, but not been able to articulate very well. which is the concept of environmental justice. And it's a topic that is widely discussed here in the United States, more so than in other countries. And so I'll be talking a little bit about environmentalism and how that includes diversity and inclusion of all people. And when I'm thinking about the word diversity, I really want to think of it in terms of nature, biodiversity, but also in terms of people, where we have ethnicities, backgrounds, and all kinds of nationalities. So the US EPA, which is the Environmental Protection Agency, traditionally defines environmental justice as the fair treatment and meaningful involvement of all people, regardless of race, color, national origin, or income. And this is in regard to the development, the implementation, and enforcement of environmental legislation. And so in reality, these policies that come about intersect with social equity and conservation issues. And they end up affecting the spatial distribution of toxic waste, of pollution, and they also affect the spatial distribution of protected areas and green spaces or areas of nature. And this is something seen in the United States, but across the globe in general, that there is a clear disparity seen in the exposure to either toxic pollution or the lack of exposure to green areas. And the disparity is seen between race, it's seen between wealth and social status, where certain communities are more likely to be exposed to harmful industries and less likely to access nature. And so this concept, as I mentioned, is present everywhere, but it really first came into widespread recognition here in North Carolina, which is where I'm based at Duke University in Warren County. Warren County is highlighted in blue here, and this is the state of North Carolina. So in 1982, an African-American community was designated to host this hazardous waste landfill, and they were not consulted about it. And after seeing a clear history of marginalization based on race, on ethnicity, or socioeconomic class, where certain communities are more affected by environmental degradation and less likely to access the benefits that nature gives us, this community decided to speak up. So in 1982, they decided to reject the landfill that was going to be dumped near their homes, and it sparked a chain of events. First, there was a study in 2007, which showed the first clear correlation between toxic waste dumping and race. And then in 1991, there was the first National People of Color Environmental Leadership Summit, which was, I think it was held in Washington, D.C., and it outlined the principles of community organizing. So during my first year in North Carolina, I have been incredibly lucky to take classes in environmental justice and attend talks by key speakers. And I've also been able to visit a few environmental justice communities to witness firsthand how they stand up to their rights. And environmental justice can manifest itself in many different ways, depending on the country or the region. But one key way is through community-based organizing is a key tactic to address it. So in the US, of course, there is a strong history of inspirational movements, such, for example, one of the biggest, the civil rights movement, which has been used as a model over time. And I've become familiar with some climate change organizations and environmental rights organizations that are working both locally in North Carolina and nationally. And their priorities are really to engage the public. We need to make information available on voting rights, on the kind of environmental legislation that is currently in order. But then there's also a key point, which is engaging with decision makers at both local and national level. And this is so that we can draft policies that are inclusive of minority groups, of other marginalized and impoverished people. And so community organizing really revolves around key aspects. Organizations have their own principles and values, but overall, they really talk about first of all, inclusion and relationship building, which is key, and then recognizing that it's a dynamic and iterative process. Community needs are always changing and legislation is always changing. So it has to be a flexible process. We also talk about capacity building and recognition. And this is recognizing that communities have individual needs, but that they want to be sustainable and independent, and they want to have a certain autonomy over their choices. Community organizing also involves access to resources, and this is education, money, to be a form of communication, which is two ways. So from the decision maker to the public, but also back from the public to the decision maker in the form of feedback to ensure that needs are being met. And lastly, participatory research is a key aspect, which I will speak more of later. So being exposed to the complexities of the relationship between the environment and society, I decided to pursue the certificate in community-based environmental management, which is offered at Duke University to complement my master's degree. And I really believe this is a way that I can better achieve my career goals and have a better understanding. Because educating and empowering communities, first of all, it allows a greater public capacity to invest in environmental protection. And it allows communities to value the benefits that nature can provide in form of ecosystem services. This can be as simple as having clean air to breathe, which is a public health issue. It also allows communities to have a say in natural resource use policies and be able to say what kind of nature they want to protect, which is very important. So for the certificate requirement, I had the opportunity to partner with a nonprofit organization here in North Carolina. And their goal is really to empower communities and provide labor rights for minority and immigrant youth in the agricultural industry. And they primarily raise awareness on public health issues and biodiversity damage from industrial food production. And they also manage a scholarship fund so that high school youth can pursue alternative careers instead of maintaining a cycle of underpaid and dangerous jobs in agriculture. And this is something that American communities 14 years old become exposed to pesticides on a regular basis. So the point of this organization is really to aid in capacity building by providing education and money, and also community building. And so as mentioned, all these policy changes that can come about through communication and organization are deeply beneficial for the empowerment of communities so that they are able to care for their own environments. And I would like to talk about a specific example, which is the state of Oaxaca in Mexico. And in this state, indigenous communities actually hold land rights and they have a certain autonomy over their natural resources. And this is a very important point because indigenous communities have historically been very marginalized. They often have a lack of access to resources or the legislation doesn't actually protect their rights. And as I mentioned earlier, participatory research is a key component to community empowerment. So this semester, I have started focusing on my master's project, which will be the main focus of my degree. And I'm working together with another student group supervised by experts in environmental policy and biodiversity conservation. And our project is partnering with a Mexican organization that is facilitating the process for two communities to develop a biological corridor between them. So what we mean by this is two areas are identified as key habitat, and this can be for the protection of certain species. And then an area is connected between the two to allow for this movement. And then around it, there is often a buffer zone, which allows for alternative and sustainable land use practices. So it becomes a mixed use system. And so the objective of this community, first of all, they want to provide habitat for keystone species. Here we see the ocelot and the peccary. The peccary always reminds me of our javali in Portugal. And there are also many other species, including deer. And the other objective that this community has is providing an area for alternative livelihoods, and specifically agroforestry. And agroforestry is an alternative practice to conventional agriculture, which allows people to benefit from the land, but with a reduced environmental impact. And here communities, they're already growing certain crops within the forest, and they're also wanting to expand to things such as tree resin extraction and honey cultivation. And our research is participatory in the sense that we are dedicating our project to ensuring that it's the community that holds responsibility and autonomy. So we assist local technicians and representatives to develop their own forest management plans, and we want to ensure that it meets their needs. So local technicians are also responsible for the environmental data collection. They set out the camera traps to monitor the animals. And throughout this process, we will be holding ongoing meetings, presentations, and surveys to be collecting feedback throughout the entire time and making sure that our work actually is beneficial and not just for the purpose of our research. So ultimately, we will look at the outcomes of community-based land use on the local biodiversity. And next year we will write a thesis which will advise how to incorporate conservation planning, but ensuring that it remains from the land that they live on. And this will include developing training content and educational content. And this is in order to achieve capacity building, so to allow the people to actually be responsible. And this Mexican organization that is facilitating the process, they're a nonprofit, and their goal is really about educating and empowering people to manage their own environments. And so ultimately, this is the kind of work that I would like to continue doing, working for organizations that share these visions and that really believe in bottom-up strategies and that allow for collaboration, because it's very important to have collaboration across the levels of governance, starting with the public and the people, to tackle large-scale problems such as environmental issues. So I would just quickly like to thank the Fulbright Commission Portugal for all their support and for providing me with this amazing opportunity to study in the United States. And I want to thank the faculty, staff, and students at the university that have shaped my first year and have given me these opportunities. And also, I've been able to attend very amazing conferences. And lastly, I would really like to thank all the organizations that have allowed me to witness their work and be a part of their movement.
Thank you so much, Claudia. This was very inspiring, I have to say, to see that it's just 1 year in the US, but still in terms of research, it's the impact is really
important. Hopefully.
I do have a question from Sophia to you that I will read now. Great talk, Claudia. In your opinion, what's the biggest threat to environmental justice and equality in the US today?
So on the US scale is maybe difficult, but here in North Carolina, there are many developments because the current administration, instead of moving away from fossil fuel energy sources and going to renewable sources, is trying to continue exploring alternatives. So the US is developing another pipeline, and they're also trying to invest more in fracking. And so most of these pipelines and most of these fracking industries end up occurring in land that is originally owned by Native Americans. And many of these are either not legally recognized, or they're partially recognized by the federal government, but not by the state, or vice versa. So the biggest threat is probably in the next few years in the East Coast going to be these indigenous communities that are kicked off their land. That's sometimes it's a subtle difference, and it's sometimes not clear to see health impacts. Sometimes they only occur 10 or 20 years later. So I think tracking this research and ensuring that we can connect current health issues to past actions is something that maybe we still struggle with here.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Another question for you. In your what are the most effective ways to engage youngsters?
Yeah, that's a great question. The North Carolinian organization that I partnered with that works in agriculture, they have a really great way of starting focus groups that are actually led by high school students. And so these are high school students that then maybe have the chance to win scholarships to go on and study, but they become responsible for managing their own talks and events. And so giving even, you know, children as young as 12, 14, that responsibility then allows them to care better. There's another organization as well that works with Duke University, and they're actually giving bee extraction and bee cultivation certificates. So children as young as 14, 16 are actually becoming certified honey cultivators. And then by having this physical and direct interaction with nature, they become much more excited. Their future generations can have the same experience that they have.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Claudia. And you're still in the US, so I hope that you stay well and safe until the rest of the academic year in North Carolina. And thank you for this contribution, extremely inspiring, that you gave us today.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Bye-bye. And last but not least, we have our seventh speaker, Carolina Marcos de Mesquita. Carolina is a 2019 graduate of Arizona State University, where she studied political science and English literature. She is a recent alumna of the Fulbright US Student Program in Portugal, where she served as an English teaching assistant at Politecnico de Leiria School of Education and Social Sciences. Carolina hopes to pursue a graduate degree in international relations and to study issues of peace building, gender, and migration on an international scale. Carolina, are you able to join us now? How are you? You were one of those Fulbrighters that had to leave the US before the end of your grant. So good to see you again.
Unfortunate end, but it was a great several months in Leiria, and so I'm happy to be speaking about it today.
Okay, so the floor is yours.
Awesome. Let's see. Okay, so can everyone see my screen? I believe that I'm sharing now. So good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, depending on where you are. My name is Carolina, and this last year I had the privilege of serving as an English teaching assistant with the Fulbright program in Leiria. For those of you that don't know, Leiria is a smallish town about an hour and a half north of Lisbon. I was placed at a polytechnic institute there, which was a really wonderful opportunity. Today, I'll be talking a little bit about a teaching project that I worked on while I was in Leiria, where working with the students, we essentially produced a series of independent podcast episodes, which was a lot of fun. And I think this is a really good kind of educational opportunity for English language learners. And I really want to talk about how these learners can become participants in creating new forms of media as opposed to just consuming media. Just to provide a little bit of context, I was placed at Instituto Politécnico de Leiria. It was interesting transitioning for me to working at a polytechnic institute, especially since I had such a kind of traditional humanities background, a lot of things like, you know, writing seminars or Socratic seminars. And I didn't necessarily know if that model would be totally helpful to students in a polytechnic institute where often the focus is a little bit more pre-professional. I definitely wanted to kind of draw on my background with things like storytelling and building narratives and implement some of those ideas in the classroom. But I also really wanted to make sure that we were building skills that would lead students into successful careers depending on their degree program. I was primarily working with the communication and media studies undergraduate program. So this is a 3-year undergraduate program where at least 1 year of English study is required. Most of the students that I was working with were at a B2 plus level, so fairly high speaking level. I believe that it's classified as upper intermediate high. So these were students that were conversational, that were very comfortable speaking English, and the focus of the class was really on getting them to use English in academic or professional contexts, as opposed to just on a conversational level. So in thinking about some of the things that I would like for the students to do or to learn throughout the academic year, originally I thought that it would be fun, especially in speaking to so many of the students and learning that they were interested in journalism careers, I thought that it would originally be fun to put together something like a writing anthology of their work, having them report on local issues and interview locals. But I figured after thinking about it for a while that they were probably already doing a lot of that in their degree programs, or they would do that in the future. And I thought that, you know, being in the context of the Fulbright program in Leidia would be a fun opportunity to kind of try something a little bit new or something a little bit less traditional. So recognizing that they were probably already practicing their writing in English very frequently, I thought that it would be fun to practice something more close to audio production or audio journalism. I had a little bit of experience with independent podcasting in the past, and I thought that this would be a really fun kind of opportunity for them to practice multiple ways of learning English. So obviously speaking in English, writing and researching in English, interviewing other people in English. And so I began to introduce this idea to the class of creating independent podcasts together. So in order to prepare for creating our own podcast, originally what we did was we had a few close listening activities in the class. And this was a really great opportunity for them to also gain exposure to American culture. As far as I know, in speaking with the students, I asked them originally if any of them listened to podcasts. Podcasts are very popular in the United States. People listen to them. I listen to them when I'm doing the dishes or when I'm going for a walk. A lot of people listen to them on their morning commute or just have them in the background while they're in the house. And it seemed like a lot of my students were listening to podcasts, but they were mostly listening to American podcasts or English language podcasts. And so I really wanted to encourage them with this project to think about podcasts as something not necessarily just being something that exists over there in some far distant country, but also something that could exist and that they could implement locally within their community. So to practice, we listened in class to 2 episodes, one of Criminal and one of This American Life, 2 very, very popular American podcasts. And as we were listening in class, I asked them to consider what makes an interesting audio story and what makes an interesting interview subject. So the podcast requirements were first to complete their podcast in groups of 3. I assigned the groups, which was very unfortunate for them. They were a little bit salty about that. They were very mad at me for assigning the groups. But they also, I think, ended up collaborating really well in that context and getting to know each other in a really intimate way. Originally, a lot of these students didn't know each other. This was the first semester of their undergraduate program, and so this was a way for me to kind of try and have them build a community with each other, even with people outside of their immediate social circle. I asked them to create podcasts that were between 7 and 10 minutes long. One thing that I found working with the students that was really fortunate was that a lot of them went over that requirement. They ended up creating more content, which I was really proud of them for being so ambitious. They were also required to present activity at the end for a presentation grade. And then they were also required to complete one English language interview. This was a little bit of a challenge, certainly because not everyone that they might be interested in interviewing is an English language speaker. And so to get around that, I told them, okay, it's fine if you complete an interview in Portuguese, but when you include it in your podcast, you have to assume that the audience is English speaking. And so that will mean that you'll have to do a voiceover in English. So I figured that that would be a good alternative, so that if they couldn't practice interviewing in English, they could practice translating in English, which was kind of a way to get around some of those issues. And then again, you know, serving as a practice in speaking, writing, researching, and interviewing in English, building all of those competencies at once, as opposed to a project that might focus solely on writing or solely on oral presentation. So this is a slide from the original close listening activity that we did in class. I highly recommend this episode of Criminal if you have not heard it before. It was called Mrs. Sherlock Holmes. It was released last year. And it's essentially about a female detective living and working in New York in, I believe, the late 19th century. And it's about her journey solving a murder case within the Italian-American community of New York City, and all the challenges that she faced as a female detective and all the ways that she tried to subvert some of those challenges throughout her career. So this podcast, Criminal, is generally focused on issues of criminal justice or, you know, historical crimes and the ways that they've influenced American life. But I really liked this episode because it also incorporated elements of social justice and an analysis of social inequality into the story by talking about issues of gender and the way that this female detective kind of diverted some of those issues in her career. And that was definitely something that I wanted the students to think about as they were developing their podcasts. I didn't want them to just necessarily report on, you know, some random interesting story in the context of Ladia. I also wanted them to draw some meaning from that. I think that podcasts are unique in that sense. You know, it's not just straight reporting where you're reporting the facts. There's also an element of narrative storytelling that I wanted them to incorporate. I wanted them to first, keeping in mind that not everyone was at the same level. You know, we had some basic questions like, who are the main three characters of the story, to make sure that everyone is on the same page. I also asked them to identify what type of audio story this was. There are a lot of different types of podcasts. Some of them are just interviews between two people. Some of them are narratives. Some of them are almost like soap operas. And so I wanted them to think about the different kind of goals or intentions that a podcast could have, and whether a particular podcast was meant to inform or to entertain. Certainly in the context of this episode, I think the focus was to inform and to entertain at the same time, to inform about social issues within the criminal justice system, but then also to entertain by chronicling this very exciting murder mystery that happened in New York. So they had a really good time with this, and I remember I paused right before the big reveal of who the murderer was in the story, and they were so mad at me, and they all came back the next day and said that they had gone home and listened to the end of the podcast by themselves at home, and they were really happy to have been introduced to this very popular American podcast. So that was a really fun activity to be working with them on. After that, we started to prepare to produce our own podcast, and originally I thought that it would be fine for them to record their podcasts using something like their iPhone. The iPhone microphone actually has very good audio quality, and so I figured that that would be no problem, but I ended up finding out during the first few weeks of my time in Ladia that the Polytechnic Institute had a recording studio that was mostly dormant. So it used to house the student broadcast radio station, I think in the early 2000s, but that radio station is no longer really in use. And so as a result, the studio was basically vacant for most of the time that we were there. And so I ended up reaching out to one of the staff members that worked in the studio to ask her if it would be possible for us to use the studio to record our podcast. And she was very excited. She said that she was really happy to see that it would be in use once again. And up to this point, I think that some of the students were a little bit skeptical of shifts. They became very, very excited to feel like they were, you know, in a professional recording context. Some of them talked to the staff member to see if they could come back and record things like music demos. They were really excited to be in this professional studio. And so I'll be sharing actually one of the podcasts that one of the groups produced. This was done by Tiago, Ophelia, and Chessie. And together they produced a podcast looking at cultural differences in the context of education, so the ways that different educational systems can reflect the cultural values of a particular country or region. This group, I remember, had a little bit of trouble in the beginning honing in on a project. They really seemed to want to make use of the international community that they were in. So at the time that I was teaching, a lot of the students that were in Leidia were international students from China, from Poland, from Ecuador, and they seemed to really want to rely on that international community to produce the podcast. But very frequently they would, you know, talk about cultural differences and how they wanted to produce an audio story about cultural differences. And I kept on asking them, what about cultural differences? Like, what do you want to say? What meaning do you want to draw from that? Can't you look at cultural differences through a specific lens? And I think that that's when it kind of clicked for them, and they realized that they would have the opportunity to be a little bit more specific in thinking about what cultural differences mean and how they come through in a particular context, in this case, in education. So I'm going to adjust the volume and then play.
Good morning and welcome to this episode's International Talk. Today we are going to talk about educational systems in different countries. I'm Ophelia.
I'm Tiago.
And I'm Chessie. In China, we have a saying, 少年强则国强, which means that the prosperity of the country and the outstanding young generation is closely related with the rise and fall of the country.
I agree with that. As a matter of fact, nowadays, thanks to technology, we live in a more unified world and we deal with different perspectives almost every day.
Exactly. The means by which a person is raised helps build the future. The global village enhances our connection with each other, and therefore, how influent is our education in the outside world? Related to the topic, we interviewed three international students currently studying in Portugal and asked about their home country's educational systems. Here we have Sarah from Poland, who's been here for 4 months.
The educational system in your home country is representative of the culture and the image.
So I'm going to stop there just for the sake of time. But as you can see, they went above and beyond by interviewing not just one person, which was the requirement, but three people. And I had several students actually ask me, can we interview more than one person for this podcast? And every time I would say, yes, of course, we can interview as many people as you like. I just want to make sure that it's not too much work for you. And they were like, no, of course it's not. You know, we're super excited to be speaking with other people. One of the reasons that I required them to complete some type of interview was in order to have a primary research component to the podcast, but also to further embed themselves in the community. So as I mentioned, a lot of the students were international students. Most of the Portuguese students were also not from Leiria. They were from Braga, they were from Porto. And so I really wanted to encourage them to become involved in Leiria, in the academic community, and in the larger city by participating in these interviews. And I think they really rose to the challenge, which was really amazing. So just in thinking about some of the goals and the outcomes of this project, certainly what I wanted to do was build language competency in a fun or an innovative way. I have found often that when it comes to traditional presentations, sometimes English language learners can be a little bit hesitant because they have to improvise or they're not necessarily comfortable speaking with an accent in front of their peers. And so I wanted to encourage them to speak without maybe, or by maybe removing some of that element of improvisation, which I thought would be a good opportunity for them to practice in a different context. their speaking competency. I also wanted to build technical competencies and introduce them to digital journalism mediums. Again, one of the really fun parts about this was that so many of the students didn't necessarily have experience with podcasting, but I think certainly stepping into a studio, they could suddenly envision, you know, a future for themselves working in radio, or possibly using technology and social media to produce similar forms of journalism in the future, which was really great. Building a sense of civic engagement and community involvement was certainly something else that I wanted to encourage them to do. A lot of the students focused on international issues. There was another group that focused on studying abroad and the challenges of studying abroad by speaking with international students. There were two other groups that focused on the issue of intimate partner violence, which is a big issue in the context of Portugal. And I was really proud to see them tackle such a fraught subject and be so fearless in kind of investigating those issues. And then I also wanted to encourage them to think of themselves or to begin thinking of themselves as creators of popular media, not necessarily just consumers, and to get them to think about their future participating in creating these innovative mediums. So those were some of, I think, the really positive outcomes of this podcasting project. In the future, if anyone is interested on learning more about the intersection between podcasting and education, there was recently an interview with Maximilian Alvarez in the Chronicle of Higher Education, where he talks about the ways that these can intersect, the ways that podcasting can intersect with education. Here, I'll also plug in my own independent podcast with some shameless self-promotion. So I implemented a lot of the things that we discussed with the students in producing this other podcasting project, where I basically speak with Asian American leaders in my home state of Arizona about how they're working to advance the vision of inclusivity and community engagement across the Southwest, which I think is very important, certainly now in the context of COVID-19, where we see so much increased hostility toward Asian Americans. And as a member of the Asian American community myself, this was has been a really fun project to be working on. So the link to the Spotify is there. And then finally, the focus of my project was not on this, or the focus of my presentation was not on this project, but I did want to mention one of the other really amazing opportunities that I had through Fulbright was to live in Leidia and to actually learn the story of Esteban Jiquedoyes, who lived briefly in Leidia, as I'm sure a lot of you know. He wrote his first novel, The Crime of Padre Amaru, in Leidia. One of the ironies of that is that Leidia continues to kind of glorify Esteban Jiquedoyes, and several of its monuments in the city kind of memorialize his presence there. But his book critical of Leidia. So he wrote the entire book being very, very critical of the social fabric of Leidia and small town life. And so I think that irony was very, very interesting to me and something that I really had a lot of fun investigating. And it was ultimately published by Literary Hub just before the pandemic hit. So if you're interested in link to in the slide as well. I am obviously so grateful to the Fulbright Commission for all the support that they've provided in this very tumultuous time. I had an amazing few months in Leidia, and including photographs in my slideshow of Leidia that I took definitely made me very nostalgic for my time there. And so I definitely am already planning a return very soon. So hope you all stay safe. Thank you so much for tuning in. And that's about it for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Carolina. This is really interesting. A great, great initiative. As podcasts grow its popularity here in Portugal, it's amazing that you were able to do that. I do have a question from Sofia. Podcasts create communities and are an accessible medium, but aren't they also a means to
Yes, absolutely. So we did actually in class talk a lot about issues related to plagiarism, and also one of the things the students encountered very frequently was challenges in interviewing. So in particular, you know, how do you identify an interview subject who's an expert on their topic? How do you do effective research on a given topic? So we did do several workshops throughout the semester in preparation for completing this podcast. Issues of plagiarism and voyeurism, I would say, are also kind of characteristics of journalism in general. And so I also did ask a lot of the students to rely on their own backgrounds, taking other communication and media studies classes to address some of those issues. But we definitely, in private and also in the class, the context of the classroom, addressed some of these issues as they came up. I was also monitoring pretty closely who the students were interviewing, what type of research they were doing, because I did want to make sure that they were on the right track. And I also drew upon my own background working in student journalism to respond to some of those issues. But mostly we responded to those on a need or case-by-case basis. So whenever the students had any particular questions or any particular concerns, I met with them individually and privately, especially if the topic was a very fraught issue, as, for example, the podcast about intimate partner violence. Very, very emotional, very sensitive topic. And so I worked with them very closely to make sure that the research that they produced was sound, that the people that they were interviewing were experts in the topic, or if they were not, that was communicated to the audience in an effective way. So I definitely see that, and I tried to respond to that in the context of the assignment as best as I could.
Thank you. I have two more questions, and then we'll have to wrap up. From Elaine Avila. Hello, Elaine, how are you? What were some of the main differences you observed between American and Portuguese education / students? And I'll ask the second one, if it's okay. The initiative of using podcasting in Leiria had continuity with the other professors, or when you left, did it terminate it, or did it continue? So, two questions.
Yeah. So I'll answer the second one first. So this was actually just done in the first semester of classes. And so I did not plan on continuing this project beyond that, but my mentor in Leiria, who teaches there, has taught there for over 20 years, has said that he thinks about implementing it with the next year's cohort as well. In the spring, my plan was to have the students work on a photojournalism project, so using another medium, but that did unfortunately get kind of swept to the side after the pandemic. And so that was, but hopefully they were able to absorb as much as possible from, you know, our time together with the podcasting project. I would say that one of the biggest differences that I observed between American and Portuguese students, it's difficult to say. I think what was interesting was that because I was so close in age to the students, it didn't necessarily feel like a typical professor-student relationship. So, you know, in class, when I was a student, I always called my professors doctor so and such, you know, and I was always very formal, and there was a little bit of, I think, distance between me and my professors traditionally. But a lot of these students, you know, they just called me Carolina, you know, they would just send me emails that said, hey, professor, hey, teacher. And you know, I had coffees with them. One of my fondest memories is of the first week that I was in Leiria. I had a student come up to me at the end of class, and he said, you know, is it possible that I can interview you over a coffee? You're the first American that I've ever met, and I would love to learn more about your country and where you come from. And we sat down at the cafe later that day, and he pulls out this notebook, and it has 3 pages front and back scrawled with questions to ask me about the United States. And so we start talking, and the first question that he asked me is, okay, can you explain to me the judicial system in the United States of America? And I was like, all right, we're going to be here for a while. And so that was a really, I think, fond memory that I have. And I would say that that characterized most of my relationships, not only with the Portuguese students, but with the large number of international students that I was working with as well. So that was certainly a lot of fun, and I'll definitely hold those memories very close to my heart.
Thank you so much. Now ask those attending the Zoom conference, if there's any further questions to Carolina or to any of the speakers. A few speakers had to leave early, but we still have Beatriz Albuquerque, Flávio Azevedo, Claudia Meca with us. So if there's any question for those speakers, we still have a couple of minutes to go through those questions. If not, okay. Professor Elsa, would you like to say something as a close?
I have one more question to Carolina. Okay. What happened? You have a great initiative at Polytechnic Leiria in English class with your students. What happened at the end of the semester? You went back to United States. I imagine that class is going to be provided by another professor, maybe a professor from Polytechnic Leiria, I don't know. That kind of initiative of teaching English and increasing the English using podcastings and technology applied to journalism. Did it continue, or the facilities, the infrastructure that was there but was in, it was not in use, stopped, and the English language continue being taught in the traditional way, I would say?
Yes, I'm not necessarily sure about my mentor's plans for English teaching for the next cohort. So I was working closely with a mentor who's a long-time professor at the Polytechnic Institute of Leidia. And I believe that he expressed interest in continuing this project in the future. But for the most part, I envisioned this as just being one project that we worked on within the course of the semester, not necessarily like an ongoing extracurricular project. I would love to have the students continue it if it's interesting to them. That was not necessarily the way that I envisioned it in the future, but certainly I think after seeing the students so excited about some of the possibilities associated with podcasting and audio journalism, a lot of them expressed interest in returning to using those facilities. The recording studio, I think, is used on a sporadic basis. I think that now, for the most part, students use it for individual projects, but it's not necessarily in use at the same rate as it was originally when it was used for radio broadcasts. And so I would love to encourage the students to continue using it either for podcasting or for other projects. I do believe also that as the students accelerate in their degrees and they become students in the Communication and Media Studies program in their second or third years, there's production, I think, for them to using alternative mediums in the context of journalism and English language learning.
Thank you, Carolina. We have some questions from to Beatriz Albuquerque. There were at the time we had no time for her to reply, so I'll read the questions, and then Beatriz, if you are available still, you can answer those. We heard from Antonio Guterres, and I already asked the same question to Don before. We heard Antonio Guterres, tsunami of hate across the world. How can artists work together and be a force against this trend? Beatriz, are you there?
Sim, estou aqui. Problema técnico.
No problem.
Sim, pronto. A primeira questão que a Sandra fez, quando ela...
I'm sorry, I just
speak Portuguese because when you become bilingual, you automatically... So what Sandra asked first was, how do you deal with hate? And hate, like crisis and all that, has been art for a long time. Like, for instance, what I have behind me is from the Guerrilla Girls. And in this case, some of them are based in Chicago, so I met them. And their art was about, more about inequality, about the woman role as an artist and how you are invisible. And that's the way that any woman can join. So I joined them in the 90s. I did some things with them as a group. So artists usually have a lot of groups how they deal with all that. So when she asks how artists are going to work towards that, well, you always have this tendency to join, to create art and also do activism related to it. I remember another project that I have with a group of persons, they're Portuguese based. We have two groups, different artists. One, it was called the protesters, and that was in the time of the crisis, and that culture was completely cut all the fundings. And during that time, there was a group of artists that thought, okay, we're going to protest it. Manfredo was already protesting, burning the museum, some of the artworks that he have, and we did the same, like a protesting against the cutting of culture. I think in this case it's going to be the same, because there is hate all the time. I have another group also with some of them that's called To Affront since the 90s. And what we look for is to affront people about things that I don't feel comfortable with. It can be nudity, it can be sexuality, it can be LGBT, it can be all that. And in that case, we do have reactions. And that's what we look for. We look reaction, we look to affront. Like one of the exhibitions we did a couple of years ago, I show one of my videos, and the passerbys, there was two women, they complained to the policeman in Porto. In Lisbon, there was no complaint, but in Porto, they complained to the police, and the police was there and say, legally, we can do anything as art is related. But what worries them was the sexuality. They didn't accept male body or homosexuality, and that was the complaint. But they didn't complain about the female bodies, because that in art is usually seen. So I think artists, when there's a problem or a crisis, they join together, they do groups, they go against that trend, and they work towards it. In related with the second question, that is about 3D printing, well, the 3D printing I do is PLA, which is cornstarch based. And related with that, that's biodegradable. For instance, I just printed 6 months two rings. I'm going to show you. One, I never use it. The other one, I use it. And I think with the camera, you can see it. So the down one, in 6 months, it's already becoming shading away. The other was never used, this one. Why? Because the material, when it's cornstarch based, it can be biodegradable, and that implies with humidity and water. That's why with preservation, the art of my art, I'm really strict humidity or pull it in water, because that's one of the problems that, because the 3D printing that I do is biodegradable, it can come apart as an art object, which means at the same time, there is less waste. Related with recycling, it also depends what prints you do. For instance, I can do 3D printing in chocolate that we can eat. I can do it in ceramic, is another one of my ceramics. So it implies everything is a ceramic. Related with waste, when we do 3D printing, there can be waste, it depends. Some 3D printing don't have wastes, because you can print it in a way that the outcome is the final. But when there is waste, it's called the support. I'm going to show this one. In this sculpture here, you have the support. This, when detached, like when it's detached and stays normal, you have all this PLA. Well, PLA can be recycled. You just do a mold and you reprint it again. You can do it as a filament, or you can do it as a mold. In this case, I actually did it as a mold, but it can also be a filament. So it depends what you choose. With 3D printing, you do ABS, it's a no. PLA, like me, you have two things, it's biodegradable, and then as an artist, I like to recycle material, because why waste? And all related with paper and so on, that's the two things for it. So in my case, there is not a way for mitigating the problem, because there is no problem. With other people, it's their choice. So.
Thank you so much, Beatrice, and thank you for picking up the questions that were unanswered before, and that's very nice of you. And as a way of concluding, I would like, of course, to thank all the speakers for your contributions, all the participants that were here for the whole afternoon. Thank you so much for the Fulbright team that for putting this event up, especially Dora and Dorian, who had the bulk of the work of this project. There are still slots available for May 22nd. If any of the alumni that were with us this afternoon felt inspired to share their projects, please get in contact. We have room for you in the session of May 22nd. I would like to invite you all to attend the forum again next week, and hope that you stay well, safe, and healthy. And I wish you a nice weekend, and thank you again for being with us this afternoon.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
It was a great section. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks.